Let us now make the official definition of our tensor product. So this is due to von Neumann. And this was in a paper of 1939. Ah, very beautiful and detailed paper. Yeah, and so what is our setting? We have Hilbert spaces, Hi, indexed by the natural numbers. This should be Hilbert spaces. And we want to define such a tensor product, but as I said before, what we should do, or if we want to do this, what we need is we have to fix unit vectors in each of the HIs. So that's part of the data, so the tensor product will depend on this. So we have Hilbert spaces, but in addition, we also have, for each HI, we have a vector EI for each I in N. And this should be a a fixed vector. So this we are fixing from the beginning for each HI, we fix an EI. And this should be a unit vector, a fixed unit vector. So it should have norm 1. Yeah, and then for this data we can define a tensor product. Then, and I mean that's what von Neumann calls an incomplete tensor product, but we are only talking about this, so I'm not using this incomplete, so I'm just calling it a tensor product. Tensor product. But I will, I mean, it depends on the choice of the EI, so I will also put this into the notation which I'm using. So I'm writing the tensor product, but I'm not only putting the HI here, but each HI comes with this vector EI. So I'm writing it like this. So what is this? Yeah, I mean, this is just the completion of taking linear combinations of elements of this form, but for which I guarantee that this makes sense by asking that I consider here first only vectors which starting from one position are always equal to this EI. So this is the completion. Okay, maybe I also should factor out null vectors. There will be sequences or linear combinations of them which have norm 0, so I should of course factor those guys out. So after factoring out null vectors, the completion of the linear span, so I should take linear combinations of, now I'm taking as elementary guys from which I start such infinite tensors, but I make this requirement that the tail is somehow constant. Okay, so I'm take the linear span of, let's say, the set of guys which I could write them as a sequence, but of course in the end I will write them as this tensor sign. But let me do it here as a sequence, infinite sequence. So the element xi comes from the ith Hilbert space, but not arbitrary, but I require that for all but a finite number of i's, these xi's are all equal to the corresponding ei. So for all I in n, okay, not for all, okay, so xi is in hi, this is for all, but then in addition, I require that xi is equal to ei, and of course, I'm not requiring this for all, but only for all but finitely many. Okay, so for each such guy, I mean, I have three, the first ones can be as they like, but then starting from some point on, they should all be equal to the EI. Yeah, okay, so I'm taking the completion of the linear span of such guys and the completion with respect to this formula here. which of course for any two choices, so for a choice X and a choice Y, this infinite product here now is just essentially a finite product, because the tail here in this the factors starting at some point on are all equal to 1. So the real information is just the finite product. So it's this completion here with respect to inner product, which is given by this formula star. Yeah, good. Okay, and so this means I'm starting with vectors which up to some point are arbitrary, but then they are equal to EI. But of course I can shift this EI essentially to infinity. So this means I also have vectors which are a sequence of x's. But of course it is clear that this completion will favor guys, or will only consider guys, which in their tail behavior are not very far away from the vector EI. I start with the guys which must be equal to EI from some point on, but then I allow of course the completion, which means I can move to more general ones. But essentially this means that the XI must be close to the EI. And maybe we try to understand this a little bit better in the following remark. Yeah, but before we do this, maybe we come back again to this idea that what we're really doing here is an inductive limit of finite tensors, where we have embeddings of a tensor of n factors into a tensor of n plus 1 factors, and this embedding is given by the choice of the EI. So this is really what this fixing of the EI means. So the fixing of the vectors EI, one for each of the Hilbert space, gives us actually a way of embedding the finite tensors into each other. So it gives us a way of embedding H tensor N in H to tensor N plus 1. And of course, I could also take here the product. Let me say it more precisely, because the H's can all be different, even though in the end maybe we consider the situation where they are all the same. Let us look here on the more general case. So I can embed H1 tensor Hn into H1 tensor Hn tensor H n plus 1, and this is of course given by, if I have something here, I must put something here, and of course there I have this canonical choice of this one fixed vector from here. So H1 tensor Hn, I can identify this with H1 tensor Hn, and then if I want to go into Hn plus 1, I should put something here which is like a 1, at least for our purposes. So at least with respect to the inner product, it behaves like a 1. And so this is our vector En plus 1, which is a fixed vector in Hn plus 1. So this guy here is now identified with a subset of the tensor product of n plus 1. Factors. And so maybe this you should compare to what we said about this embedding, which works nicely for the direct sum, but which, when we talked about this in 9.3, was not clear how this should work for the tensor product, but now we have somehow a method for doing this. Yeah, but this embedding tells us that now if I look on elements of this form, which are not necessarily constant, starting or not equal to this vectors EI, if I start at some position, that they should be considered in the following form. So elements, let's say an element x, which is of the form x1, tensor x2, tensor x3, and so on, infinite tensor product, which should be an element in our tensor product of the HIs with respect to the fixed choices of the EIs, that this we should understand as this guy here, as the limit of taking just the first n components of this and then putting the EIs at the rest and then taking the limit of this position n going to infinity. So this means that this guy, so this element, have to be understood as looking on the limit where I'm taking x1 up to xn, the first n factors in this tensor, but then from this position on I'm just putting the EIs there, so I continue here with en plus 1 tensor en plus 2 and so on. This is an element which we have in the set which we consider here in our definition. Good, but we can of course move this position where we switch from the x's to the e's to infinity. So this is going to infinity. A vector of infinitely many x's, a tensor of infinitely many x's, should be understood, and it means this here. Okay, so it has to be understood as this. And maybe from this we can get an idea what we really need, that such a guy is really an element in our Hilbert space, in our tensor product Hilbert space, because it means that this limit must exist. And this is now a clearly defined object, because I mean each of those guys is in our Hilbert space, so we know what its inner product is, and we now just have to check that with respect to the norm given by the inner product, this limit exists. This has a meaning. And of course for this, we have here products of the x's, and of course maybe the easiest to control situation is where we assume that all the x's also have norm 1, because otherwise we have to control the infinite product of those guys. But in order to make life easier, and because that's the situation in which we are mainly interested is, let me assume that I'm only looking here on elements where all the xi's have norm 1. And then let us see whether we can understand maybe a bit when such a limit exists. So then the existence of x as a limit requires, so what do we want? I mean, we have here a sequence of elements and we want to see that this has a limit in a completion. So this means that this sequence should be a Cauchy sequence with respect to the norm which we have defined here by the inner product. So this requires that if I take two elements in this sequence and I look on the difference between them, but they should become arbitrarily small if we take those elements just far enough in the sequence. So this means we should compare, let's say, the nth element, so this is x1 tensor xn, where then from this position on I put the e's there, tensor and so on, I should compare this with the mth element in the sequence where I'm putting the e's only after position m. So I take x1 up to xm, and from this position on, I'm putting the e's there. And now the rest is all e's. So I should see that this guy here, that this can be made, let's say, smaller than epsilon if I only make n and m big enough. That's just the Cauchy condition for our sequence. So this gets arbitrarily small for n and m, large enough, so bigger than n, which of course depends on epsilon. So that's a what it means that this has a limit in the completion. But of course, so what is this here? So this norm here, so this is now, these are elements for which we have this formula for the inner product, and of course starting at some position, let's say M is the bigger one, so starting from position M in this product here we will get only only once. So this what I have here, maybe let me write it like this. Maybe, I mean, those guys here up to position n, they are all the same. Then from n to m, they are different. The first guy has the x's, the second guy has the e's. So here I can write now for the first guy xn plus 1 up to xm. But for the second guy, for this guy, I have at this position, the other way around. So maybe this guy is the second guy, and the first one is the one which has already the e's starting at position n, so I have it also at position n, n plus 1 up to position m. Okay, so this is the plus term, so this is this guy, and this minus term is this guy, and then from this position on I just continue in both cases with the em plus 1 tensor em plus 2 and so on. So I have the norm of this for this quantity here. And now of course the norm of such a product is just the norm of the products of my guys, because for the norm I have to take the y's the same as the x's, and so this means I'm getting the norms of the x's here, and then I'm getting of course the norm of this part here, and then I'm getting the norm of the e's, but the norm of each, the product of the e's, but the norm of each e is equal to 1. So what I get here is now the product of the x's, but the x's we also assume to have norm 1, so I don't have to bother what happens with this. So the only thing which is not equal to 1 is the norm of this part here, which is a tensor from n plus 1 to m. So what I really have here is now the norm of, so this is actually the first term, so let me write it as the first one. So this is en plus 1 tensor em. And this I have to subtract minus this term here, xn plus 1 tensor xm. Good. Okay, and so what is this? Now this is now just an element in the finite tensor. I can of course calculate the inner product between them, and so what I get in this case, maybe let me write it here. So this is now the inner product for a difference, or the norm of a difference. So in terms of the inner product, I'm getting the inner product between four possibilities. So I'm getting the inner product of this with itself, but this is of course 1. Then I'm getting the inner product of this with itself, which is also 1, twice the minus, so it's also plus 1. And then I'm getting the cross terms. I'm getting the inner product of this with this and the other way around. And they I'm coming with a minus sign. And the inner product of this with this, of course, is the product of the inner products between the first factor and the second factor and so on. So what I'm getting here is the product of the inner products between, let's say, ek and xk, where I'm running here from k from n plus 1 up to m. And then the other term, where I'm getting the inner product between this and this, again with a minus sign. So minus the product from n plus 1 up to m of xk and ek. Yeah, okay, and so the condition which I need is that this product here can be, or this quantity here can be made as small as possible if I only make n and m large enough. And so this essentially shows us that, of course, those guys here must go to 1, and what one really needs here is the difference of those guys to 1 is a summable sequence. So this, to ensure this, so the right condition to ensure this, and also all the other things which one needs to make all this going. Of course, I mean, this is not the only thing which one should check, that I have a nice limit, but one also has to see that inner products also have a limit on all this. So and for this, the right condition to ensure this and everything else is that if I take the inner product between ek and xk, so those guys here, I mean, they must, for k going to infinity, they must be close to 1, and they must be actually be so close to 1 that this guy here is summable from 1 to infinity, that this is less than infinity. So if I have this, then this ensures that this guy here will go to 0 if I just make n and m large enough. And it will also ensure, for example, that if I take 2 such sequences, an x and a y, which satisfy this property, then also the inner product, which I have erased between the x and the y, will also have a limit. Okay, so this here is the condition which we need, that infinite tensor products, x1, x2, and so on, are in our Hilbert space if the norm of the xk is equal to 1. If the norm of the xk is not equal to 1, I also have to control the infinite product of the norms of the xk's. Okay, but if we restrict to the case where the xk's have norm 1, then this is actually what is the condition that an element x1 tensor, x2 tensor, and so on, infinite sequence here, is in my infinite tensor product hi with respect to the ei's. So it really means that I can have elements where all the factors are not equal to the corresponding ei, but they cannot be far away, namely they must be very close. In particular, if I'm going to infinity, the xk must be very close to the ek, so that the inner product between them is close to 1. So here I assume that both of them are unit vectors. Good. Okay, so this gives us hopefully some idea. I'm not proving all those details, but it's really about how to control infinite products. And maybe if you really want to see it very detailed, you should look on the original paper of von Neumann. Good. Okay, but now we should see how our choice of the tensor product depends on the choice of the EKs, because we have here many tensor products, infinite tensor products, not just 1, but for each choice of the E's, we have a tensor product, and of course the question is, are they in a sense the same, or are they different, and can we really control when they are different?